Well, if nothing else, this proves that Fusion is the most photogenic and awesome of the different Grand Challenges. It is an amazing thing. So now we're going to bring up the panel discussion on Fusion, and that will be led by Andrew Klein, who is a professor of nuclear engineering and radiation health physics at Oregon State University. From 2005 to 2009, he served as the Director of Educational Partnerships at Idaho National Laboratory and as Department Head, Radiation Center Director, and Oregon Space Grant Director at OSU. His research interests focus primarily on the utilization of advanced nuclear energy systems, including space and fusion. So please welcome Andrew Klein.
Good luck.
It's quite a privilege to be here with this wonderful group in this wonderful environment. I grew up in fusion a long time ago and then wandered away from it for a few years as well, so it's an interesting chance to see all the great things that Ned and Ed have been doing. I'm going to invite Ned and Ed back to the stage to join us in the chair and introduce our last speaker here before we get into the panel piece. Farouk Najmabadi is the director of the Center for Energy Research at the University of California, San Diego. Farouk has his PhD from the University of California, Berkeley. He's been involved in fusion I've known him for a long time. It's a great chance to reintroduce ourselves and get acquainted again. And he's going to talk about the activities of the U.S. community. More of the holy grail of nuclear energy systems.
Thank you very much. I have about 10 minutes, and I want to try to focus on where we go from here to have a commercial fusion power on grid and reality. Most of my research the last 10, 15 years has been working with a team of scientists to look at what a future fusion power plant looked like and try to optimize the system, try to understand what the issues are in order to guide R&D. And so I'm going to use a lot of that information. First and foremost, just like everybody else, I have to say a little bit about energy, but I want to spin it a little bit differently. We heard a lot about energy consumption, energy use, and energy shortages, but it would be good to put some numbers there so that we understand the magnitude and scale of the problem. The world primary energy use is, if you average it over a year, 14 terawatts. That's 14 times 10 to the, I have to even do it in my head. 10 to the 12 watts. If you try to look at a joule, it's 0.5 exajoules, 10 to the 18 joules per year. That's equivalent of 11 billion tons of oil. Very high, okay? So when we talk about energy challenge and how we meet it, we have to think about terawatt scale, not kilowatt scale, megawatt scale, but terawatt scale. The other part is that the energy market in the world, the sales is $4.5 trillion. It was in 2004. Electricity market was $1.5 trillion. It's a lot of money, okay? If you look forward, we expect that the world energy demand or use or need, however you want to see it, grows by 50%. It's a growing market. It's very large and would grow faster, grow bigger. Lastly, as previous speakers discussed, 80% of energy today comes from fossil fuel. And either because of global warming and or fossil fuels running out, we have to replace them with new technologies. I submit to you that looking at the dollars and the size, this is going to be the electronic revolution of the 21st century. And as students, you want, or recent engineers, you want to consider going to energy market field because this is going to be a long career. And various disciplines would be needed in order to solve this problem. Now, as mentioned, fusion is special because it satisfies automatically, because of nature of fuel cycle, a cell condition of sustainability. It has large supply of energy resources. It has high power density, so it does not use a lot of resources like land. It has minimum byproduct. But the problem is our grand channel, make the system into economically feasible technology. And I want to underline economically feasible. So if I look at the requirements for fusion energy, I can count them into four general categories. The first one is make fusion reaction happen. That means confine the plasma and heat them to fusion temperatures. And you have just heard two excellent talks that we are building machines or have built machines that would do that. I don't think anybody would doubt the scientific feasibility that we can make copious fusion amount of power. The issues are how to optimize the system so that they become commercialized, meaning that minimize the cost. How do you make a smaller devices? How do you make smaller magnets or lower power lasers? And I want to explain that we have done a huge amount of progress. If I can compare fusion research, for example, to aerospace industry, the first fusion machines we built in the 70s were like balloons. We basically filled them with gas or put power in them and let them fly to see where they go. Today, we fly them like an airplane with 1970s airplanes. We try to control them. We are having control surfaces, motors, and so on. As example, if you look at the top of the chart, a series of yellow cross-sections. Those are the cross-sections of plasma we make currently in our tokamaks. We can change the shape of the plasma by control it in real time. And these changes allows us to have higher performance system. Moreover, we can change even the profile of pressure and current inside the plasmas. This is done both experimentally, and we can see the simulations on the right-hand side. And finally, we are reaching the point that we are doing feedback control system, meaning that we look at the plasma, try to optimize the system further. In order to get to a commercial reactor, we have to move forward one step further. We want to go from 1930 planes to 2000 fighter planes, where everything is controlled and high performance is achieved. The other issue is extracting the fusion power and breeding tritium in order to generate your power system. And to see the issue, let me start with my little power plant down there. If I look at what the plasma sees, the plasma generates X-rays, neutrons, and ions, and this is incidence on the material wall. And that component, which we call first water blanket, has to generate power from there. The issues are that we have a very harsh environment. It has very high surface heat flux due to X-rays and ions. You have erosion of first wall because it's hit by ions. You have radiation damage by neutrons because neutrons go through the structure, collide with nuclei, and damage the crystalline structure. You have volumetric heating by neutrons inside the system. And if you have a liquid metal and magnets, you would have magnetohydrodynamic effects. The system in this environment has to have two major functions. It has to breed tritium and manage the tritium production, and also maximize the power recovery. And of course, you have constraints, because this is an engineering system. You want it to have to be simple manufacturing technique, cheap, and you want it to be safe and reliable. So let me take one of those constraints, because engineering is the art of finding a system that solves all the constraints and environments, and take a look at what issues are. And I take the radiation damage as an example. We want the system do not generate radioactivity, so you can go to the table of elements, look at the radioactivity generated by every element when it's bombarded by neutrons, and if you take all the elements, that radioactivity goes away less than 100 years, you end up with a bunch of elements that's written there. Then you can look at those elements and see what kind of steel or manufacturing or structural material you make. And basically, the choices are not large. There are ferritic monoclinic steels or composite vanadium refractory alloys or tungsten. Now, the issue is that, of course, you put these materials in a radiation field, and we know when you put materials in a radiation field, you have an operating window. At lower temperature, the material becomes embrittled, so it cannot operate, it breaks. At higher temperature, you would have a thermal creep. So basically, you have to design your system so it operates at that small temperature window. That's, and again, another constraint introduced in the system. In the fusion, in addition to the damage that we see in the fission system, we have also large amount of helium generation, and that may cause changes in the material structure. Now, why we are worrying about this temperature window? You know from Carnot that the efficiency depends on how hot you can make the structure or your coolant. And how low can it be? Because that's rejected. So we want that temperature window being larger. As part of my work, we look at designing these components, and we have developed these concepts, and we have even used smart engineering solutions in which we can develop systems where the coolant temperature is higher than the structure. But these are at the level of conceptual designs, and we need substantial R&D before we get there. So I want to complete with just giving you some thought on how we can meet the fusion challenge. And I think we need three ingredients, because I'm pretty sure somebody would ask me, why is fusion taking so long? The first issue is that we need national will and resources. That is that we want to develop a new energy technologies. And I submit to you that we have not had this will for the last 30 years. The public funding for energy research is down 50% real time since 1980, except the last couple of years. And to put this in perspective, world energy R&D expenditure is 0.25% of energy market. And I want you to recall the CEO of GE this morning said that he spent in a private company 5% of its sales in R&D. We have to spend 20 times more in order to be competitive. The second issue is stable funding. Unfortunately, the energy R&D funding in the US last 20, 25 years, since I was a graduate student to now, it basically follows inversely the oil prices. Although, as we know, the oil and electricity don't correspond, but we have had peaks of funding and trough of funding, and that has made difficulty in terms of planning a program. The second issue is manpower. In order to fill these machines, these products, we need a lot of young engineers to come in the field to replace people like us. And lastly, we need to start thinking about fusion energy missions. Up to now, rightly, we have been focusing on providing and demonstrating scientific feasibility of fusion, but we have to start thinking about how you make the machine that works into a commercial reality. And I came to fusion program wanting to work in fusion. Probably I was the first generation that went to school and wanted to do this. And I still think the way I thought when I went to Berkeley, because I think we can do it. So with that, I'll stop.
While we're getting up to the lines and get some good questions from the audience, I've got one to start off with. One of the amazing things to me about fusion, and especially in the magnetically confined fusion, we go from roughly the coldest temperatures in the universe to some of the hottest temperatures in the universe in the length of my wingspan. That's a very tough engineering challenge. And it's good to see that we're getting around to the engineering challenges now once again and moving forward. We're almost there to ignition at NIF. We have ITER building, and so it's really wonderful. My question is, what do the three of you think are the two or three really big breakthroughs that you need to see this happen, besides more money, in the next 20 years? Because fusion's always been 20 to 30 years away as long as my lifetime. So what are the two or three things you think are the most important breakthroughs that we need to see?
Well, let me start with magnetic. I think that we have a good understanding of the plasma behavior for the externally heated plasmas. What we need to either confirm or learn more about is the self-heated burning dynamics. And ITER is going to address that for magnetic fusion, NIF is doing it for inertial and the like. So clearly, burning plasmas are the next major step. Then, and in I hope in parallel, we have to address the sorts of challenges that Faroe mentioned, which is we have to come up with good radiation-resistant, low-activation structural materials. And that will allow fusion to be environmentally attractive because you won't have a large amount of waste that you have to worry about. Within one human lifetime, these materials can have their activity drop to the point where we can recycle them and reuse them. Okay? And thirdly, we have to learn how to handle the power so that we have a competitive system where we have high power density on the first wall and we make use of those neutrons to breed enough fuel, because tritium, you know, was created at the Big Bang, lots of it, but it has a half-life of only 12 years, so it's all gone, okay? The only tritium we're seeing these days comes from various reactions, such as has happened to produce tritium, and this is for various purposes. And we have to use a lot of it in fusion, and so we can't count on an external supply. We have lots of neutrons, there's lots of lithium, and I think we need to learn how to actually breed tritium so we're self-fueling.
Ed?
I sort of have a different view of this. My view of it is, and I'm going to assume that we're going to get a burn on the NIF, because if we don't, there's nothing to talk about. And there'll be a lot of explaining to do, because that will mean all of our models of many things that we know work are wrong. So, you know, I'm assuming that. And I think the issue is how to transition into an industrial point of view and an engineering point of view. And in the ICF community, you know, there's a very nice thing that the laser, the target, and the heating of the salt are completely separate physically and temporally. And this gives you a lot of opportunities for engineers to be very creative in how they do things. And it also gives you opportunities to develop the laser, the targets, and the first wall and cooling system independently. And my view of it is, how do you get the semiconductor industry model, since everything we're going to build is semiconductor compatible, working this case? And I think we're ready to do it. They're ready to work with us. And I think to move from an R&D program to a engineering technology economic program is the transition. And a lot of good ideas don't make that transition. So I think that's the issue. And we've been working very hard to understand that. And I think we have talked to people in Europe, Japan particularly, and Silicon Valley, which is in our backyard, about how to do this. They're tremendously interested in participating.
So I agree with what Ed said, that the major problem we have, or major issue in front of us, is to make the system commercialized, a field-operated system that is commercially available. A major issue that I would see as a breakthrough is society understanding of energy technologies. It is very important that people understand the scale of the market, $1 trillion, which requires R&D investitures of $50-100 billion a year if you go with your 5% model. That's number one. And the second one is the fact that, again, the slide that Ed showed, it takes a long time for technology makes it into market. We saw that on electricity, but I can give you an example of the cars. If tomorrow somebody comes up with a car that can drive 100 miles per gallon, it would take probably 25 years before the cars on the market all like that. It takes 3 or 4 years before you can build the car, tool your factory, set the factory together, do your all the requirements. And then industrial production of the cars is 5% of the market. So it takes you 20 years in order to reach to that point. So when you think about energy markets and energy policy, you have to think about tens of years time scale, tens of billion dollars, because the scale, time scale and money scale is much larger than what we are used to. And unfortunately, the political system requires a crisis, and they want to throw a lot of money on it to solve it right away, and that doesn't work. So from my point of view, I would like very much, when I talk with politicians, to bring this point, that this is not a 10-year solution. You have to think about 20, 30, 40 years down the road.
A political breakthrough.
Could I just add something to that? You know, I think that, you know, and I have no interest in being critical of anything that, you know, the Obama administration says. But I think the point here is just, it's just so fundamental. The inertia of money and capital is so incredibly high in a multi-trillion dollar business. And no one's going to turn off all these coal-fired power plants if you wanted to. If you had to, you heard a story this morning from Dave about what happened in England when that happened for a few days, right? Governments get thrown out. These are really hard problems. And I think that, you know, students and society has to be thinking very carefully about moving rapidly into new capabilities, but understanding the inertia of the system they're in.
Thanks. I see we have one there.
Yes. I was just curious. It seems like with inertial confinement, you have a general idea of how you will convert the fusion energy into electricity that we can use. But with the magnetic confinement, it seemed to be missing that final step of turning the what seems to be a feasible concept into something that we can use to actually create electricity. And also, it just seems like fusion itself releases so much energy and it has so much potential. Do we even have the means to fully harness all that it's producing so that it really is a positive energy source that we can really feasibly use?
Well, that's for Oja.
Since I am one of the people who have been looking and, at the fusion power plants, and especially in the magnetic side, now we have conceptual designs which have been basically analyzed to death in the context that assuming that the systems work as it's advertised, material properties are as assumed, they would generate electricity at competitive cost. So the statement that you made is not correct. We know how to do this. The issue is, in order to, for a system to be filled, operable, and commercial, you need to do a substantial amount of R&D to make sure that your system doesn't break, it works all the time. You know, the operators, which are not 1,000 PhDs, are not continuously fiddling with the system. And it's cost competitive. And those require substantial amount of R&D. And so, I think we know how to do it. The question is, do we want to take that step and make it into a commercial reality?
Yeah. I think the issue of fusion energy, you know, when I said the sun, you like it because it's, 100 million miles away, is sort of an interesting point. And that's why, whether you're looking at inertial fusion energy or magnetic fusion energy, the scale of the plant is 1,000 megawatts. That's what we do every day in coal or gas or nuclear. They're built to be scales that not only are manageable with power generating equipment that we have, but the grid that we have. You know, you could build them actually bigger, but grid size, chunkiness, and stuff like that becomes uninteresting to the utilities and management of markets. So that's sort of the range that people look at. And so, you know, you can look at them in funny ways, like a burning capsule in ignition is an exawatt, but it's only on for 10 picoseconds, so you get 100 megajoules. 100 megajoules 10 times a second. Just think about it that way, and it sort of works fine.
Also, on ITER, we are actually installing 6 different breeding blanket modules, so we know how to do it. Matter of fact, we have a multiplicity of ways to do it, and what we have now are various partnerships between the ITER parties to address various concepts, to build prototypical blanket modules and install them for test.
Another one?
Yeah, I was curious. I went to school at Wisconsin, and there was a group there that was very interested in helium-3 for fusion, and there was a former astronaut, Harrison Schmidt, who was interested in, I guess, getting the helium-3 from the moon. But I was just curious as to where you thought helium-3 fit into the fusion energy picture.
Well, pairing with Harrison Schmidt is Jerry Kolsinski, who's in our audience. We have two of the big champions of helium-3. I think it would be great. It would significantly reduce the amount of radiation that's produced, the amount of damage to the materials and the like. The only problem we have to overcome is that it has a lower reaction cross-section, and so we have to learn how to produce higher performance plasmas in order to use that fuel. But I have no doubt we're going to learn to do it eventually. We've chosen DT both for ITER and for NIF because it is the highest reactivity fuel and gives us the greatest probability of success. But I don't know what the final ultimate fusion reactor is going to look like. I'm sure there are going to be very many smart people who come up with ways to burn more exotic and more attractive fuels. And I really hope that happens. It's going to require work in optimizing the confinement of plasmas so that we can get the plasma performance such that helium-3 reactions can actually be self-sustaining.
You know, we are actually using helium-3 already in NIF, but we use it because of the number of nucleons, you know, that you have, and you can do deuterium helium burns and get the sort of same number of nucleons as DT, and look at downscattered protons and other things. But that the problem with helium-3 is just tough to burn, right? And it's sort of a more advanced option. There's several others like that that would be very interesting in the long run, but I think it's a big step for now. It's hard enough, right?
If I can add to it also, that in addition to the fact that it's much harder to burn, the neutrons actually have a very useful purpose. 80% of the power comes at neutrons, and they deposit that power volumetrically. And if you design the system correctly, it deposits the power directly in the coolant. So instead of a coal power plant where you have heat exchangers, you have a gas plant where the coolant is hot and it comes out. If you go to advanced fuels where the power and neutron channel is small, everything goes through your material wall, so they make material wall engineering difficult. So there are trade-offs that one has to look at. And I don't think we are yet there to understand and quantify those trade-offs.
Well, one of the other parts of the Holy Grail is a perfectly ion or neutron-less plasma. That really is the far out. Fusion, you're just saying that would be very difficult to remove the energy. I know direct conversion is possible, but I know we've talked about that for many, many years.
Yes, right? So the reaction that Andy is talking about is proton boron 11, and if you go through the numbers, you would not get ignition on it, so I have difficulty.
Yeah, we always, whenever that one comes up, you know, we say, well, if NIF were again another 100 times more energetic, you could do those reactions. That's not happening tomorrow.
No. 20, 30 years away. Next.
This actually goes a little bit more towards policy and education. The relatively small amount of coverage that this has been getting, I've heard a lot of incorrect statements, even from reputable news organizations, about the science behind the plasmas, the safety of the plasmas, the waste that's created, the safety of the waste that's created. It, again, the few people that know I work in plasmas that talk to me on the street, so to speak, really there's this no understanding. Everybody seems to think it's this huge nuclear thing. It's going to keep making nuclear waste. The plasma could blow up. We're going to have a sun on the planet. Is there anything built into ITER and NIF for education, policy, just general publicity, I guess, of correcting misconceptions?
Oh, yes. We're working hard at that. We come to events like this, for example. But in addition to this, we're trying to get exhibits in museums. We're trying to get them on TV shows. I'd love to see an LA Fusion Engineer TV show. Actually, we were back about 10 years ago. I remember at the National Academy of Engineering, we were talking about how to make engineering a more popular profession, and we were talking about the LA Engineer series. But anyway, we have to get out there and make ourselves more visible. And we have budgeted to go into museums. We have science teacher days and weeks and months and internships. We develop packages of material. You can go to websites to try to find educational material that can be used in K-12. We try to get fusion science and fusion engineering faculty into the various universities. That's hard to do, actually. And we're trying to make our presence more known. But essentially, we think we have a good product to sell. We're quite proud of it. We think that we can produce a system that is quite safe. It's hard enough to keep these things going. They're not going to go run away on you. And so We can build them in a way that does not produce a lot of high-level radioactive waste. We don't produce CO2 and the like. And I think we have something that we should be able to sell. I'm not an expert in communicating with the public, but we've hired some people to help us with that. And any suggestions you've got, please come see me.
Okay. Well, I'd like to add to that. I think we're terrible at it, and I think it's plagued the nuclear industry since the earliest science fiction movies like Them and It and stuff like that, and that if you're old enough, you saw in the 50s and never have stopped. And I think that the issue that you're bringing up is a fundamental social issue that is particularly important in Europe and the United States. It's not important to first order in Asia. They're moving ahead without this around their necks. And I think that this is something that we do the way Ned said, which is the way we respond to the world, not the way the world responds to us. And I think this is, when you heard this morning that engineers should learn more about sociology and political science and stuff like that, I think this is a major issue. If you're going to go into big science, you will find out this is more drives your life than the interesting technical issues. In fact, what I've learned on NIF, and I tell this to many people, NIF is I think all of big science is a social event, occasionally interrupted by technical difficulties, but not the opposite. So I think this is a very good question and a very good point.
But I also think it's more present in the U.S., maybe Europe, than it is in Asia, as you mentioned. If you go to Asia, I go to Asia because many of our ITER partners are Japan, Korea, China, India, et cetera. You turn on the TV set there, they have programs there that they talk about fusion reactors. They have kids that come up to you. I mean, I typically go with a shirt that has ITER on the logo, okay? And there are kids that walk up to me and ask me about fusion reactors because they see ITER. Now, how many kids here in the United States would see ITER on the logo and come up and ask you about a fusion reactor? There's a cultural issue here, but it's also an emphasis of these different governments. About 10 years ago at the International Atomic Energy Agency's fusion meeting, Pradyuman Kau from India gave a speech about how it is essential for the developing nations to have fusion reactors, lest they go through the same development path that the presently developed world went and abuse the atmosphere by throwing that much CO2 into it. They are looking to work with the developed nations to produce an energy source that will be environmentally attractive. And they are focused on that. You can talk to the leadership in Korea, and their government is dedicated that they want to produce a fusion reactor. They have a program. They can tell you exactly what their time scale is. They have budgets that they're working with their government to get. Japan is similarly motivated. China is motivated. India is motivated. The developing nations are very interested in developing advanced energy systems, and it's present in their school systems and their curricula. It's on their TV programs. They're very interested, and they know it's important, and they're going to make it happen.
Sure. Very, very short. I actually find very large interest in, when I go talk in high school, in science and engineering-oriented students. They usually know what the issue is and have no problem. The issue you raise about the stories in media, I personally feel is connected to several aspects. Number one is, as scientists, we usually fail to communicate to a public the merits of what we are talking about. From my point of view, the detail of what's happening inside is so cool. But from a public person, he doesn't care. He sees this box with wires coming out, and the question is what goes in, what comes out. And so we have this divide that we have to conquer. So that's number one. I have attempted to talk with the environmental groups, and what I have found is that 9 out of 10, once you start engaging them, are very interested in fusion power. There are 1 in 10 that they say, this is nuclear, I don't want to have anything, and walk out. but 9 and 10 gets very involved. So we have to do that outreach. A third part of this problem is our media. Our media is not technically savvy, and they love murder and mayhem. So false goes all around. I think we have to do a much better job.
My experience is with the media, though, they're very willing to talk to us if you get the right ones anyway. They're very willing to talk with us and allow us to dig down deeper. And I think young people like you ought to be encouraged to do that, because the media people typically are your age, so you can communicate with them very well. So I'd encourage you to turn that table around and go contact your local newspaper and say, why aren't you covering fusion? See what kind of, if they even know what it is. It'd be very interesting. Thank you. Any other comments?
Another one over here. Following up on that, actually, I was wondering if in the roadmap for nuclear fusion, there's any sort of discussion of commercial additionality along the way to the point of having nuclear fusion commercialized itself, in the sense that right now the roadmap that's laid out seems to be, by analogy, it's almost like a tunnel, and you're on the other side. If we just invest enough, we're going to get there, and everything's going to be great once we're the other side, as opposed to a freeway where as you move along, as we're developing technologies, you have these exit points. So as you move forward with your superconducting material development, we also get superconducting storage. Or as you move along with your salt development, we also wind up with a solution for solar thermal, and there's a lot of commercial development. Just the way the semiconductor field developed, where at first we had transistor radios. I mean, very, very ancient, literally transistor radios this big, but it brought us Elvis Presley. You know, and then as you moved on, you wound up with color TV, and you moved on and you wound up with personal computers on the desktop. And so is there any sort of thought about putting together a roadmap that actually sort of articulates a vision of, you know, it's going to take 50 years to get to nuclear fusion, but in 5 years we're going to have this great thing that's out there, and that's why you should invest in us, and we need to get there to the end point.
So you're asking, are there intermediate technologies that can be spun off, like NASA always claims for the space program?
Yeah, exactly, and how you can wind up using that to articulate.
Well, I can answer that. You know, in the inertial fusion energy, I think this is the roadmap. And because the lasers will be semiconductor lasers and the targets are nanotechnology, and we have a pretty rich intellectual property portfolio that we've developed, and I agree 100%. If it isn't that way, I don't believe it will ever happen. And when we talk to people who are interested in commercialization, you know, whether venture capital or actually banks or utilities or process heat people. And I think that the issue that was brought up about direct applications versus electricity is really very important and misunderstood by our community totally, is that if you have to wait, like you said, 50 years to have anything, you will have nothing. And if you have to wait, you know, in their world, more than 5 years to have product to sell, you also won't have anything. So I think in the IFE world, we're really thinking very hard about this. And there are ramps on and off into this intellectual property and into licensing that we think about all the time. And the thing that I like about IFE, you know, and I've always liked about it, is the separability of all the technologies. And they are going separate, you know, in parallel and spinning off. And in fact, from NIF, you know, I hope none of you have a pacemaker, unless it's helping your life, of course. But, you know, the technology we developed for the capacitors are now in pacemakers. And there's lots and lots, you know, the commercial codings that we made for optics are all over the place, and actually developing a reasonable stream of funding. And I think your point is right. I think if we live inside a science world, I don't want to say die inside a science world, but that's where we'll be.
Anybody else want to comment? Okay. I see we have one more.
Yes, some of us are environmental or ecological engineers too, and we've learned actually through our fields, but also the everyday life, that all our acts have consequences. In fact, it seems like the long term, the consequences of what we do seem to be more costly than the benefits. At least we were talking about the second principles of thermodynamics earlier. Well, this principle teaches us that the consequences of some of what we do are actually more costly than the actual benefits. We just heard that, you know, we should educate the media. I would like for you to tell us, what are the long-term consequences of the new technologies you presented to us on the planet Earth, on the general ecosystems? We do know that the current technologies, which are based on fossil fuels, seem to have a dramatic consequence through the greenhouse gases. For what I've seen so far, there seem to be little to no consequences, and that kind of goes against the second principles of thermodynamics. I would like for you to tell us what are the actual true hidden costs of the technologies you're presenting.
And also the first principle of skepticism.
You know, the second law of thermodynamics is often thrown up as some, you know, in social events as some, you know, second law of thermodynamics is, you know, enthalpy. And I think we should be very careful about how we use that in social events because it isn't. But nevertheless, you know, the issues of the unintended consequences of anything we do are, you know, sort of the things that system people and philosophers have to think about all the time. And we really don't know everything and how it plays out for lots of reasons. The thing that's so interesting about fusion, and it always has been so interesting about fusion, whether it's MFE or IFE, is that when you think about it, you know, you need a little lithium, right? And you need a little deuterium, and deuterium is in water. You know, one out of 7,000 drops of water, the first order is deuterium. And the issue of long-term nuclear waste is very small. In fact, over time, can be vanishingly small if you go to silicon carbide and stuff like that. And, you know, there doesn't seem to be, because if you were successful in doing fusion, any particular downside. Now, that doesn't mean that the use of that energy won't come to some, you know, if you had that much free energy, you wouldn't do something incredibly stupid with it or something like that. So I don't know where that boundary that you talk about ends, right? But it looks like it's non-proliferant technology. It looks like it's a technology that has all the fuel you'd ever need. It looks like if you can make it work, it would be fairly inexpensive. It looks like it could be put around the world. It's too good to be true. So the question you're asking, the real law of social skepticism comes in. Is it real? And I think that's where the world is right now. And I hope when NIF burns, you know, we will have a situation where people will, you know, move past that question, either for both IFE and MFE, and then move on to seeing where we can do with it. That's my view anyway.
I can tell you that since I do a lot of studies of what the fusion power plant looks like, we do a lot of safety analysis and decommissioning analysis, and I would be more than happy to share the results. In fact, I have view graphs too, but maybe I can show you on my laptop, that we try to estimate what is the waste that is generated, what happens if there is an accident, and so on. And this is a very special power source for several reasons. Number one, the amount of fuel in the chamber, the energy content of the fuel in the chamber is very small. Either inertial fusion or magnetic fusion, the fuel that is burning inside the chamber is very small. It's like one stick of dynamite in a very huge building. And secondly, it is very hard to keep it going. As soon as it left out, it would basically stops. And so, it's very different than our thinking about power sources like, you know, a coal plant that you're worrying that the fire gets into your coal supply, or a fission system that may run away. That's the arguments that people argue about. So fundamentally, the inherent nature of the way power is generated makes it very hard to generate a large accident. Because the fuel's small, very hard to burn. That's why we have all these wonderful machines to make it burn, because they're difficult to burn. So if one of the systems doesn't work, the machine stops, the reaction stops. If one of the lasers don't fire, the pellet won't ignite. If one of our coils in the tokamak stops, the whole thing stops.
I think the issue that comes up, can you make it economic? The cost is, if you can make it for a dime a kilowatt hour, you're in. If you make it for 50 cents a kilowatt hour, you'll still burn, what you'll do is burn coal. That's what I think the story is.
Another question?
Well, first of all, I'm very glad to hear the great progress you guys made on fusion. I would like to have your comments. Well, you probably just mentioned a little bit. We heard a lot of good things about fusion, but what I would like to know is your comments about the safety issue. This gentleman just mentioned a little bit, but. As we know that the current nuclear fission plants, we have a lot of those plants in the world, and there are some accidents happen. And what if accidents happen with these fusion plants? Are you going to generate huge bombs like a hydrogen bomb, or how do you handle the issues like that? Thanks.
Well, let me start on it. There have been several rather authoritative studies done on the safety related to fusion power plants. I don't know, is EasyCom still the leading one, bro?
No. But too old, but.
And anyway, if you look at the key elements, one question you mentioned was, could it blow up like a hydrogen bomb? Well, the energy that is accessible to explode in some sense is just the fuel that's potentially ignited. And as Faro said, it's a very small amount, both in magnetic and in inertial. And as such, the explosion potential is rather small. Also, it's very unlikely that you ever get anything like a runaway reaction, because the more likely thing is the thing shuts itself off. Okay. It's very hard to keep these things going. You can't have a runaway reaction if you don't have any more fuel. So you run out of fuel, you burn it all, and it's all over. So from the point of view of lots of radioactive waste, I think you can make a stupid plant that produces lots of radioactive material, but you have to do that by using the wrong materials in your structure and in your radiation shielding and the like. If you're clever about it, you can make it a very attractive system that does not get activated in the long run. Or if it's activated, it decays rather quickly, and you bury it for a few years, and then it comes back, and you can recycle it. So I think you have to look at these studies that have been done both within and out and outside the fusion program to see that they have analyzed these accidents and have come to the conclusion that there are no big accident scenarios. In the case of ITER, we're of course applying to the French regulator to operate ITER. We've prepared our safety documents. They've been presented to the French government, and I believe they're about to the stage of public hearings. So at that point, these documents all become public, and you can get access to them. Just contact my office, and we'll try to put you in contact with those people. So I'm quite confident that the accident analyses that have been done well, and have determined that such reactors and such power plants are safe.
You do have some stored energy, though, in those magnets and some other the special chemicals right. Make it dumb. I think that's a problem.
Right, but that's not going to endanger the public. That's going to cause you to lose your investment.
Right.
So if you're talking about safety, you're not going to have people in the vicinity of those magnets, and there's a lot of structure around them such that if the worst were to happen and this thing were to somehow start distorting itself and flying across the room, it would be obstructed by all the walls.
Right.
So it's contained. Now, it may be an economic disaster because you've just destroyed the power plant, but it's not going to hurt anybody.
And of course, it's a very local radiological event.
Right. Okay, so I want to talk about ICF. Just talk about the target. So the target is the size of a peppercorn, right? And if you look at these, if you look at these signs around the room, right, these exit signs, they have about 20 times more tritium in them than the target does. And during if you get it to burn nicely, you burn about a quarter of the tritium, right? And what happens is, as first you work very hard to put it together, and then it goes up to around a billion degrees. Somewhere around a billion degrees, it works very hard to take itself apart. So it turns itself off. So that's, you know, when you go through all the theory, it's very hard to burn more than a quarter of the fuel. And the amount of energy in a quarter of the fuel is, you know, if you did it really well, is 100 megajoules. And 100 megajoules, to go over this, is 100 donuts, you know. That's how much energy it is in calories. Now, so what's the worst accident that you could have? That you said some miracle happened, you burned 100% of it, which it's impossible, but say you did. So you get a little bit more energy out. As far as the system is concerned, it's a very small amount of energy compared to the thermal capacity of the blanket. And there is no perceptible change in the temperature of the blanket. There are no magnets. There's nothing like this. It just flows. The latent heat in the blanket the stored energy in the blanket is, you know, measured in very easily. And there is no latent heat because there's nothing to keep heating once you turn it off. So it burns for a few picoseconds. The neutrons are absorbed in a few microseconds. Then it's off. And then a tenth of a second later, you turn it on again. So it's very much like your engine in your car. It's just going pop, 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 pop. So the whole idea of bomb scenarios and stuff like that are just one of the unfortunate, you know, this question we had about how people report it or how they think about it is something we have to work on because it always comes up. And I think we should stop using the word reactor. Call it an engine. Because I think that's a what?
Stop using the word donuts.
Well, okay, we won't use the word donut.
excuse me. I think that the issue of safety probably isn't there, especially compared to other technologies. But in closing, and I know it's over, what do you want us to do? The challenge is huge. You've outlined it, and you've got money now. What is it that you want the engineering community, relative to engineering education or anything else, to help solve your challenge, other than tell me you need some new nuke engineers, et cetera? Is the workforce going to be noticeably different? Should we be working on that? I mean, the technical workforce, the people around the system. Do you need a different style of engineer? What is it you want us to do?
If I can answer that, given the Dhamma University person, I think the high technology research projects and enterprises are a great way of attracting very good, talented students to engineering and sciences. This is a two-way street, in the sense that the projects we work on can capture the imagination of young people to bring them into science and engineering. And in return, these people would become the workforce to push towards realizing this enterprises. And it should be something that you have to work together, both in the terms of bringing new talents in and then finding work for them so that they are very productive in high-tech area.
I think the answer, and it was discussed this morning, is, you know, I know that the kids you're teaching are really smart, you know, and really capable and will do work greater than anything we've done before. What I think they have to learn is interdisciplinary, you know, teamwork. Because none of these programs will go forward by the work of a single investigator, even though single investigators might make some important discoveries along the way. This is really large teams of people in many fields, you know, looking at system studies, social studies, technical studies, manufacturing, you know, licensing, it's really kind of, you know, from my point of view at this point in my career, it's kind of fun. You know, it's a very broadening experience dealing with, you know, as you said, the international community and the like. So getting students to understand that is what I would like from faculties, if I had one question to answer.
Okay, and my answer to that is I believe that the engineers have to recognize that they are problem solvers, they are innovators, designers, creators, and the like, and they are in a position to understand the problem that we face regarding energy. And I think that our country has to become more aware of the challenge that energy presents, and to make it a more active public debate, more visible, more informed, and we have to manage to get our electorate to recognize that this is a problem for which there are solutions, but we have to make up our mind and commit to solving those problems. So I think that the engineering community is in a position to understand and then to explain. And you should be advocates for solving the energy problem.
On that note, that's an excellent suggestion. If we could just get everybody moving in the same direction, we'd probably be there. So, thank you so much, and thank you so much.